Hi there, beautiful dreamers, and welcome back to Emiya Soleil Dreamwork. On level 3, the dreamer begins to see the wider context of the timeless sources of wisdom. Here is the portal to myths and to fairy tales, and here the archetypes and great symbols appear. The dream mentioned last week was interpreted on level 1 and on level 2, and now we will look at it out of a third level's perspective. A short repetition of the dream. A woman kneeling at a tree stump at the end of the road, weeding and making space for a rose bush growing up between the shallow tree roots. A spiritualist priest approaching, wanting to clean the place, but whose help is neither wanted or needed. Since the theme was cut down tree stumps, the end of roads, and dubious male characters, I found that the story about the maiden without hands would be suitable. And this is how it begins. Once upon a time, there was a miller who had fallen into poetry. His mill was broken, so he had to go to the forest to chop woods. One day, when he was hacking at a tree stump, an old man appeared and said, "I will make you rich if you only give me what stands behind your mill." "There's nothing about the apple tree," thought the miller, and said, "Yes." The old man laughed and said mockingly, "In 3 years then I'll come back and take what belongs to me." And then he vanished in the forest. The miller returned home and his stunned wife asked about the newfound wealth. The house was filled with riches of different kind. And better than that, the mill was working again, faster and more effective than ever. The miller, grinning from ear to ear, told his wife about the old man and the apple tree. The miller's wife froze and said, "You stupid old fool, it was the devil you saw. He did not mean the apple tree, but our daughter who swept the yard behind the mill." The miller's daughter was a beautiful and pious girl, and the 3 following years she lived in fear of God and without sin. The day the devil came to get her, she washed herself carefully and drew a circle around her with chalk, and therefore the devil couldn't come to get her. Furious, the devil said to the father that he should take the water away from her so she couldn't wash, because otherwise he could not have any power over the maiden. And since the miller was scared of the devil and did what he had told him, therefore he took the water away. When the devil came back, the girl had cried so much, so her hands were perfectly clean, and I knew he was a hinder to get her. And now, of course, he was even more angry, and in his wrath he ordered the miller to chop the hands of his daughter. The miller was shocked and said, "How could I possibly chop the hands of my own daughter?" The devil answered him that if he didn't, he would also take everything else from him, and for himself the miller would belong to the devil forever and ever. Well, the miller asked his daughter forgiveness for what he was about to do. She replied, "I'm your daughter, do with me what you will." She took his sharpest axe and cut off both her hands. The poor maiden wept and wept, and the tears ran down her arms and mingled with the blood that poured from the stumps. And when the devil returned once more, he tried to claim his prize, but still he couldn't, since her tears had washed the stump clean. Muttering darkly to himself, the devil slunk up back into the forest, because he really had lost the power of the girl. The miller said to his daughter that since he had been so rich, she could live there with him and her mother the rest of her life in wealth and splendor. But she answered him that she couldn't stay. She was going out in the world in trust of there would be kind people giving her what she needed to survive. So off she took and wandered in the forest without knowing where she was. And for a long time she was quite lost and more hungry. One night she came to a royal garden, and in the moonlight she could see that the garden was filled with trees bearing so much fruit, and oh, what a wonderful sight it was. She was so hungry, but she couldn't enter the garden because of the moat, and she was so hungry, so she fell on her knees, totally famished. But then, lo and behold, an angel appeared who bended a branch down to her so she could eat from a delicious pear tree with her mouth. The royal garden belonged to a king, and since he was curious about the handless spirit-like girl who had been helped by an angel to eat his royal fruit, he had been told this about the mysteriously shining girl by his gardener who had watched it all from a distance. The king fell in love with the maiden. He had silver hands made for her, and she became his queen. As always in fairy tales, danger is lurking, and even if one could think the poor girl had her share of misery already, the devil, who was still in a bad mood for not being able to lay his hands on her because of her unblemished soul, did what he could to take revenge, and therefore he interfered when bid was sent from the king's mother to the king, who was at war, that his queen had given birth to his son. The king instead received a message saying that his beloved has given birth to a monster, to the devil's child, and after terrible emotional upheavals, bid was sent back with orders to kill both mother and child. The king's mother, who had written the true letter to her son, couldn't believe what her eyes told her, and she wrote back to the king to clear things out. But of course the devil saw too that everything was wrong and worse again, and it all ended with the king's mother sending the eyes and the tongue of a deer she had killed instead of the queen to her duped by the devil's son. And the poor queen, she took off into the forest again, now with her son. She was very scared, she was crying her heart out, of course, but an angel came to her help again, then showed her a cottage deep in the forest where she could hide with her son. She stayed there for 7 years, and one of those days her son fell into the water. Since she had no hands, she couldn't help him, and desperately she cried for help. An angel appeared again and asked her why she didn't help her son. And when she pointed out obviously that she had no hands, the angel told her to try. And she did, and the miracle happened. Her hands grew back again, and she lifted her son up from the water. Wow, new life grew back. Well, the story ended happily for them after a few more obstacles. The queen and the king reunited at last, and then he had wandered in the woods in search for his loved ones for 7 years, and after she had convinced him also that she was his wife, even if she had hands now. So let's begin looking at the symbols in the first part of the fairy tale from the first level's perspective. The miller is an authority, an active one, a rash aspect. Getting poor means losing power. Going to the forest, seeking unknown solutions. The devil, egoistic, challenging thoughts. The mother, reflection and worries. The daughter, the inner truth, the conscience. Washing means holding the inner truth high. And drawing a circle, having faith. The symbolical dreamer of this fairy tale experiences loss of authorian power, fumbles in the dark when the hidden thoughts becomes solutions that challenges the conscience. Ignoring the inner knowing about what's right and wrong creates great worries, and an inner struggle begins. Let's look at the initial dream again. What if the answer to what had abruptly changed the life path of the dreamer could be found in this timeless tale? In an interpretation on the second level, the scenario points at the external events, the traumas and wounds from real life. The father as an authority and the devil as in his egoistic solution in the fairy tale, and the mother is passive, and in that way not protecting the daughter, who is a victim of her father's egoistic solution. Her own ability to act is taken away from her, and in time the father seeks forgiveness, but his daughter can't stay. She has to find her own life. So one can clearly see that the end of the way and the cut off tree in the Miller's daughter's interrupted safe life and cut off hands is seen in the dream, where the initial life path is cut off. It's also easy to identify the spiritualistic priest and the father and devil in the same person, having full authority over her life and ruining it. Both the male and the female is the symbolical dreamer in the interpretation on level one, then, has to be said. Remember also the daughter from the Taking Back My Face dream, actually symbolizing the dreamer kneeling at the stump also, telling the priest to bugger off. When she dares to approach the dreadful polar bear, telling him that he will not harm her because she is his daughter. Quite a transformation from being the Miller's daughter, initially telling the father he could do whatever he wanted because she was his daughter. Well, mixing dreams with sagas and myths like this is dream work on level 3. Everything is available, which means synchronicity is to expect, like in symbols found in real life, supposedly by coincidence. When the dreamer in the initial dream stood on her knees, she was on an upward slope at the end of the road, and the maiden fell on her knees out of hunger and tiredness outside the royal garden. When falling down on one's knees, it symbolizes surrender. And when doing that, new opportunities comes, since one has let go of the old. In the dream, new life was growing, as in the rose bush, and in the tale, an angel appeared. And remember, the devil doesn't always represent evil or egoism. And that's the point in understanding the double symbolism. He may also be a challenger who initiates awakening and growth. If looking at the tale psychologically and archetypal, the daughter has to free herself from her parents' patterns for her own individuality to grow. Her ability to act is hampered, and the devil is pointing that out. And after trials and tribulations, the Miller's daughter, her hands grew back. It wasn't the same hands, but she for sure didn't take them for granted after that. Her confidence to her own work and her love to herself had grown. And I'm pretty certain also of the fact that if the devil came along, she wouldn't listen to him, but she would actually tell him to bugger off. And if her father would try again to cut off her hands or some other part of her body for that sake, she would roar to him that he would not harm her because she was his daughter. And this kind of growing comes from the inside, from a calling from the soul to move on with life and get greater understanding. And it can be compared with the myth of Persephone, where the young girl, the innocent Cori, disappears from the meadow when picking flowers. She's dragged down to the underworld by Hades, symbolizing the devil. In this myth, it's not a blindfolded father selling his daughter, but Zeus himself, the highest god, and also, not to forget mentioning, Cori's father. In his almightiness, he gives his approval to his brother Hades to take the young girl, his niece, and this is done without even asking her mother Demeter or preparing his daughter on the coming trauma. In other words, he treated her like if she was his property, just like the Miller's daughter thought her father had a right to do, since she was his daughter. It's not difficult to see the need of growing out from such a destructive pattern, especially when it comes to the male side of the story. Giving one's daughter away to a marriage with her old uncle is not far from selling her to the devil. That and other horrible oppressive situations has to be dealt with, and it begins with harsh initiations, where one has to break free from bad situations. Like in the myths, as in real life, danger appears whenever an innocent goes. Back to the priest in initial dream, who was identified by the dreamer as a religious woman with authority. Even if much of the suppression of the feminine in this world could apparently be blamed on the male part of humanity, this should be understood as in the active force, more like solely man. Like in religion, with a masculine god, masculine priest, and feminine subjugation, male-dominated companies, objectification, and so on. It's part of the old masculine-dominated world, and it's a prison not only for women, but also for men. It actually has to do more with the active force of the society than female versus male. When going through an initiation where the inner struggle grows, where the inner strength grows and one becomes able to stand up for oneself, saying no to oppression, it means being able to break destructive patterns. And when doing that, it helps liberating others who are stuck in the common drama. It is time to change the theme of the world from the inside. It's always the inside where we start, with oneself. When finding judgment and condemning aspect in oneself, it's because it's time to learn from them and transform them. And even finding the inner courage to change one's behavior, it means igniting the bigger change. Just like taking one's voice back or face back, finding one's inner strength, being able to say no to oppression means the initiation for a bigger change. This is all part of the end game, or lower-oriented dualism. We are all climbing in a tree of life, and it's about time we take the great leap upward. The archetypes are all around us in sagas and myths to teach us what is going on in the world from age to age. History is repeating itself in many ways. And now we have come to the end of the road. The life-giving tree has been cut down in many ways, and we have to learn to grow new hands, create our own destiny through saying no to what we in our hearts know is wrong around us. Violence, racism, injustice, abuse and starvation is part of an old oppressive system, and that system has to bugger off because new life is growing. Did you notice that the number 3 was used as a special number? The quantity of years until the devil should come back. And there's a limited number of the attempts he had to claim the maiden. There's great symbolism in numbers, and without going too deep into it, I'll mention that 3, coming from the Kabbalah as an example, means a rich man wanting to share his riches or punishment with a poor man. So this is clearly be seen in the fairy tale as a devil and Miller situation. Also, I want to point out symbolism in a dream where the woman is kneeling, hacking weeds at a tree stump when the priest shows up. The situation is kind of a copy also of when the Miller in his poetry is chopping wood and the devil comes along. The difference is here that the woman has grown new life and matured, and she knows intuitively that she doesn't need the help from the priest. Maturing needs time, as in number 7 in the fairy tale mentioned as the amount of years for being lost in the woods. The number of 7 is an ending number. It's about what has gone a full leap and being ready for a new beginning. So with all this said, I just want to thank you for listening, and don't ever lose faith, because everything is learning and developing. And even if the trials and tribulations are pretty harsh, new life is always coming from the tree stumps, and then it grows back because of having faith. So bless you all, and pay attention to your dreams, and much love. Bye bye.